Hello, this is Dan Alasso with History for Today. This is going to be the second lecture of my U.S. History 2 series. And similar to the first, this one is about that period at the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th. But the direction that I want to look at it from in this chapter is from the perspective of the West. The end of the 19th, beginning of the 20th century is the time when the frontier in the continental U.S. is closing, and simultaneously the U.S. is starting to stake its claims and to develop its interest in acting more on a world stage. And obviously I think those two things are related. So to begin, the 19th century of course saw the expansion of the United States across the North American continent. Westward expansion had begun really with the Treaty of Paris, which ended the Revolutionary War in 1783. In that treaty, Britain ceded all the territory between the coastal colonies and the Mississippi River. Now, this wasn't necessarily territory that Britain occupied or controlled. It was mostly occupied by Native Americans still, but it was something that the British Empire had claimed. These regions became the Northwest Territory. And settlers arrived rapidly, and the states of Ohio and Indiana and Illinois were admitted in 1803, 1816, and 1818. And of course, in 1803, Thomas Jefferson's Louisiana Purchase added another 828,000 square miles to the United States, doubling the size of the new nation. And then in 1848, halfway through the century, the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo ended the Mexican-American War with the U.S. acquisition of really the other half of its continental holdings. More than half of Mexico was taken away from the Mexicans, including what is now California, Nevada, Arizona, New Mexico, Utah, and parts of Colorado and Wyoming. Along with negotiations with Britain for the Oregon Territory, this pretty much established what became the contiguous 48 states. American expansion across the continent, of course, was considered our nation's manifest destiny, and relatively little thought was given to Native or Mexican people standing in the way of that progress. Native Americans, of course, had lived in the American West for between 10 and 15,000 years. They were linked culturally and geographically by trade and travel, and sometimes by warfare. And so indigenous groups controlled most of the continent west of the Mississippi River deep into the 19th century, in spite of the fact that the U.S. now claimed these territories. Spanish, French, British, and American traders, and a few settlers had integrated themselves into many little regional economies. But no imperial power had really achieved political or military control over the great bulk of the continent. But after the Civil War, the West, now decoupled from the question of slavery, was quickly connected by railroads to a rapidly industrializing East as an ever-expanding population continued to push even farther west. The United States removed native groups into ever-shrinking reservations, incorporated the West first as territory and then as states, and then for the first time in history, by 1890, really controlled the entire land between the two oceans. In the decades after the Civil War, Americans poured across the Mississippi River in record numbers. The first westward rushes had followed discoveries of gold in California in 1849 and in Colorado, which was part of the Kansas Territory at the time, in 1859, and the discovery of silver in Nevada, also in 1859. Adventurous American men and a few women had rushed to stake claims, although many more of them ended up working for wages than actually striking it rich. Some mined the claims that wealthy speculators like George Hearst acquired in boom towns such as Virginia City, Nevada. Others worked in shops and saloons serving the boomtown residents. Some women went west with husbands and families. Some found husbands in the West. Others worked in the service industry, which included brothels that served a large population of single miners. These ancillary operations, shops and saloons and brothels and things like that, profited from the mining boom. And as many failed prospectors found, the rush itself often generated more wealth than the mines. For example, the $25.5 million in gold that was taken out of Colorado in the first 7 years after the Pikes Peak gold strike was less than half of what speculators had invested. Although that investment didn't make most of the speculators rich, it did build a local economy. The 100,000 plus migrants who settled in the Rocky Mountains were ultimately much more valuable to the region's development than the gold that they pulled out of it. Other settlers came to the Great Plains to farm or to ranch. Many began by collecting the hides of the great bison herds. Herds numbering millions of animals had roamed the plains and had been hunted by native people for food and for their hides. American industry used the tough leather for industrial belting in eastern factories and as a raw material for clothing and for shoes. Specialized teams of buffalo hunters flocked into the west to skin the herds. Using new rifles, the hunters were able to work very quickly, often taking just the hides and leaving the carcasses to rot where they were slaughtered. The infamous American bison hunt peaked in the early 1870s, with the number of American bison plummeting from over 10 million at mid-century to only a few hundred animals left alive by the early 1880s. So they were almost driven to extinction. The eradication of the bison from the plains and the expansion of the railroads allowed ranchers to replace bison with cattle on American grasslands. Some settlers went west for religious freedom. Nearly 70,000 members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, commonly known as the Mormons, migrated west between 1846 and 1868, fleeing what they perceived as religious persecution. Many historians view Mormonism as a uniquely American faith, not just because it was founded by Joseph Smith in upstate New York in the 1830s, but also because of its optimistic and future-oriented perspective. Mormons incorporated into their faith the belief that Americans were exceptional, chosen by God to spread truth across the world and to build a new Jerusalem in North America. However, many Americans were suspicious of the Latter-day Saint movement and its unusual rituals, especially the practice of polygamy, and most Mormons found it difficult to practice their faith in the eastern United States. In 1844, Joseph Smith and his brother Hiram were killed by a mob in Carthage, Illinois, while awaiting trial on charges stemming from a conflict with former Mormons in the town of Nauvoo, which Smith controlled. At the time, Smith was actually a candidate for the U.S. presidency, running on a ticket that promised protections for Latter-day Saints and for other minorities. A succession crisis followed Smith's unexpected killing, which split church membership between three prominent leaders. Two of them formed rival churches, and Brigham Young led the remaining Mormons out to the Utah Territory. Young was appointed governor of the territory by the federal government in 1850. He encouraged Mormon residents of the territory to engage in agricultural pursuits, and he urged them to be cautious of the outsiders who arrived as the mining and the railroad industries developed in the region. Mormon settlements in Utah were an important stopping point and supply point for other immigrants heading to California and to Oregon. It was free land, ultimately, that drew most of the migrants to the West. Family farms were the backbone of the agricultural economy that expanded in the West after the Civil War. In 1862, along with the Pacific Railroad Act that authorized transcontinental railways and gave a lot of federal land to those railway corporations, Congress also passed the Homestead Act, which allowed male citizens and actually also people who declared their intention to become citizens to claim federally owned lands in the West. Settlers could choose a 160-acre parcel of surveyed land, or a quarter section. They could file a claim and they could begin improving the land by plowing fields, building houses and barns, or digging wells. After 5 years of living on the land and working it, the homesteaders could then apply for the official title and have a deed to their own land. 1.6 million Americans used the Homestead Act between 1862 and all the way actually to 1934 to acquire about 250,000 square miles of farmland. treeless plains that had once been considered unfit for settlement became a new agricultural heartland for these land-hungry Americans. The Homestead Act actually excluded married women from filing claims because they were considered the legal dependents of their husbands. Some unmarried women filed claims of their own, but single farmers, whether they were male or female, found it nearly impossible to run a farm all by themselves. And so they were a small minority. Most farm households adopted the traditional divisions of labor. Fathers and sons worked in the fields, and women and their daughters managed the home and kept the family fed. The work of all family members was essential. Immigrants to America sometimes found in homesteading a chance for self-sufficiency that had been unavailable at home. Second or third sons who did not inherit land in Scandinavia, for example, founded farm communities in Minnesota and the Dakota Territory and other Midwestern territories in the 1860s. Boosters advertised in Scandinavia, encouraging emigration by claiming that the semi-arid plains were a flowery meadow of great fertility, clothed in nutritious grasses and watered by numerous streams. Western populations exploded, although a lot of the Scandinavians who got to places like North Dakota found that it wasn't exactly as they had expected, and some of them came back east to places like Bemidji. But overall, the populations did explode. In 1860, for example, Kansas had about 10,000 farms. By 1880, it had 239,000 farms. Texas also saw enormous population growth. The federal census counted 200,000 people in Texas in 1850, 1.6 million in 1880, and 3 million in 1900, which made it the sixth most populous state in the nation. So before we go on, a couple of questions for discussion. First, why is it significant that expansion westward has been a part of American history since its very start? Secondly, what was the typical experience of somebody who traveled west to participate in the gold rush or the silver rush? Third, what were the most significant results and effects of the elimination of the bison herds from the Great Plains? And then finally, how did the Homestead Act affect the West?